Hello and welcome to today's webinar on vitamin D assay testing. My name is Mary Sue Gardner and I'm a registered nurse in the Provider Outreach and Education Department. And I'm joined today by Jennifer, who's also a nurse on the Provider Outreach and Education team, as well as members from our Medical Review Department who will be helping with the question and answer portion of today's call. On your screen is our disclaimer for this event, and we show this disclaimer at every event. And basically our disclaimer says, we prepared this education as a tool to help you today, but please note that Medicare laws, rules, and regulations often change, and it's your responsibility as a Medicare provider to make sure you're following the most current laws, rules, and regulations as they stand. We will provide responses to questions based on the facts that you give us and based on the current laws, rules, and regulations as they stand today. But again, remember, if they change tomorrow, it's your responsibility as Medicare provider to make sure you're following those rules on that date of service. Also, CMS prohibits you from recording this presentation for any profit-making purposes. So since we do not know what you would be recording this for, we ask that you please not record it or take screenshots of it. Like I said at the beginning, we are recording it for you and we're going to place it on our YouTube page as an encore for today's event. Now, Medicare's full of acronyms. So there are a few acronyms that I may use today. And if I refer to something that you don't know, just go ahead and refer back to this list, and hopefully that'll give you the answer that you're looking for. But if I use an acronym and you just don't know it, feel free to throw that in the chat and Jennifer will get that answer out to you. All right, which moves us into our objective and the agenda for today. My objective for you is that you will gain the knowledge necessary to ensure compliance and successfully pass a Medicare audit of your services if you're requested to submit documentation. And we're going to achieve this today by going through the Medicare coverage criteria. We're going to talk about documentation requirements, and then we're going to go through some recent medical review findings, and I'm going to give you some examples of documentation that we actually receive that can kind of help you with an understanding of what we look for in your documentation. So understanding these elements is really essential for healthcare providers to make sure you ensure compliance with accurate billing and even optimal patient care. As we move on, what is vitamin D assay testing? Well, vitamin D is a hormone, and it's synthesized by the skin, the liver, and then metabolized by the kidneys to an active hormone, calcitriol. So an excess of vitamin D can lead to things like hypercalcemia, and a vitamin D deficiency may lead to a variety of disorders that includes things like rickets in growing children, osteomalacia in adults, bone or muscle pain, and even broken bones. And you will see sometimes patients with history of broken bones. Vitamin D assay testing is actually a test to look for excessive or deficient levels of vitamin D. So cases of excessive vitamin D, again, can cause hypercalcemia, and deficient things like rickets and stuff. So those are the things that our healthcare professionals are looking for when they do these testing and why they're doing it. We have a local coverage determination to assist our providers with the coverage criteria for vitamin D. So LCD L34568, which is listed here in the slide deck as two. And if you're following along or have a copy of the slide deck, please note that this is actually a link to the LCD. And we're going to go out and look at that in just a second. But our LCD contains information on the indications and limitations of coverage, as well as things like utilization guidelines, documentation, et cetera. So let's go ahead and link out and take a look at our LCD on vitamin D assay testing. So again, I provided you a direct link to find this LCD. All LCDs are housed on the CMS Medicare Coverage Database, or MCD database. If I go back just to cms.gov, and I want to find an LCD, and let's say, you know, I'm not exactly sure what LCD number or anything like that I'm looking for, I can go into the search. I can type in MCD, MCD, I'm just going to leave it at that. You can see here's MCD search or lookup coverage determinations. Both will take you to the same thing. I'm going to put in vitamin D assay testing, and you can see it starts automatically populating in some from various Medicare, other Medicare contractors. So I'm going to choose a state that I know is one of WPS's state, which is not Idaho, but instead Iowa, and I'm going to do a search. And that's going to bring me to the LCD and then the LCA, which is the billing and coding article. But I'm going to go back into the LCD. I just wanted to give you another way of finding it besides that direct link. Oops, let me use the actual link. And then we're going to take a look here about the information contained within the LCD. The first thing that I do encourage you to do when you're looking for any LCD is to make sure you are looking under the correct contractor. If you pull up some other contractor's information, some other contractor's LCD, we cannot guarantee that they have taken the exact same stance that we have taken on coverage. So make sure you are following the LCD for us as your Medicare paying and processing contractor. So as we scroll down and we look at the coverage guidance, this LCD goes into giving you information about coverage indications. Namely, under your coverage indications are the lists of diagnoses that help support the medical necessity of doing this lab test. As you keep scrolling down, then it gives some limitations for coverage. The limitations basically have a list of frequency limitations as well. We're going to go through all of this and break it down, but I just wanted, you know, to kind of give you an overview and where lead you to where we get the information from and what we follow when we do the medical review of these services. So again, under utilization guidelines, we have more information about frequency limitations, et cetera, and as well as some information on documentation. So I'm going to go back to the slide deck, and we're going to just move along and talk about some of those indications and limitations of coverage. As we looked at the LCD, there were indications and limitations listed. In order to perform vitamin D lab testing, there needs to be at least one of the indicated conditions that was listed. It must be present in your documentation, it must be contained on your bill, and your documentation needs to support the reason. So there are other, you know, limitations too that I want you to be aware of. And those again are all listed in the LCD, but a lot of them have to do with the frequency limitations as well. things that I do want to point out as limitations. Vitamin D testing should not be used for routine screening. And you don't want to perform assay of calcitrol for each condition listed. So basically, if you have one of the covered conditions, that gives you the right to perform this. But if you have several covered conditions, it doesn't mean you can perform it for each of those covered conditions. Unless there was something to prove medical necessity outside of the frequency limitations. And again, we're going to go through those as well. Medical necessity needs to be present. And as we go through the documentation, that's why we ask for a lot of different documentation, because we really try to pick through everything humanly possible to support that the person needs to have the test and it's medically necessary for that person on that day of service. You got to keep in mind that diagnosis alone doesn't make a service medically reasonable and necessary. And I say that because there are other things that go into the medical reasonable and necessary component. What is necessary today for one person based on the diagnosis, the indications being treated, et cetera, it may not be okay for them tomorrow. And if you think about that, just as we're talking about the vitamin D assay testing and the frequency limitations, I'm really getting to the fact that it may be good for Sally today based on when her last test was, when any symptomology she presents with, et cetera, et cetera. But if you do it today, doesn't mean just because she has that diagnosis that you can do it again tomorrow. So I hope I kind of drove that home. So as we move on and we talk about some coverage considerations, again, there's frequency limitations for vitamin D testing as well. And I'm going to kind of start covering those. Only one of the 25 OH vitamin D levels will be reimbursed in a 24-hour period. So storage and supplement components will not be reimbursed separately. Only one of the 125 OH vitamin D levels will be reimbursed in a 24 hours if it's also medically necessary. So again, as we go through, we're going to focus on those things that make the service medically reasonable and necessary. And I'm sorry, my computer is not moving as fast as I am. So if things seem to be a little off track, that's because I'm having some slowness issues. All right, so additional coverage considerations. Assays of vitamin D levels for conditions other than rickets, vitamin D deficiency, osteomalacia, and aluminum bone disease will be limited to one time a year. And then assay of vitamin D level for rickets, vitamin D deficiency, osteomalacia, aluminum bone disease will be limited to four times a year for the previously identified deficient form of vitamin D. So if there's some other identified form that comes up, then it may justify additional testing up to four times a year outside of these diagnoses. So again, those indications and limitations are listed in our local coverage determination. So I do encourage you to go out and review this, especially the utilization guidelines that identifies this information. All right, so as we move on, so we gave you a little bit of information on vitamin D and the coverage considerations and our local coverage determination. And we use our local coverage determination to make and help us with our reviews. So currently, WPS has a targeted probe and educate review that are happening in our J5A contract of work. However, this doesn't mean that this targeted probe and educate for this specific test won't carry over into other jurisdictions or parts of Medicare. So just currently, we're looking in J8A, but based on findings that come in, we can spread this out to other jurisdictions and parts of Medicare if we find that it continues to be an issue. So on the slide is a link to the information that's on our medical review page about this targeted probe and educate. And I'm going to use this link and I'm going to show you where to find that information as well. So give me just a second. There we go. So I told you it is in J5A. My computer defaulted to J8A. My computer defaulted to J5A. So you'll just want to make sure that, you know, any information that you're looking for on our website is specific to your place of service. However, if I back all the way up to the landing page and I go into Topic Center and I go into Medical Review and I've already moved myself to J8A Part A and I go into the targeted probe and educate, you can see we have information on vitamin D3 lab tests, which is the same page that that direct link I gave you takes you to. But I always like to show you how to find this information on your own, because who knows if you'll, you know, keep the slide deck, et cetera. So this goes into a little more information, you know, how CMS gave us permission to do this review. We link you to the LCD as well. We give you some documentation guidance for successful review, and I'm going to go over all of that with you. And then any additional resources that we think are pertinent to help you pass medical review on the service. So I'm going to go back to the slide deck and move on. And we're going to actually move into that documentation for successful review. So on the slide deck, as well as on the screen, as well as in the slide deck that you have in your hand, is a list of documentation guidelines. And I want to take a little bit to go through these just so you can get a better indication of why it's important to submit the things that we request. As with any labs, we need an order for the lab. So the physician order or non-physician practitioner, if it's allowable, in your state and via their practice acts, whoever that practitioner is that made that order for the vitamin D lab service, we need to have that submitted if we request documentation. The documentation notes should also contain rationale for the vitamin D lab test. So what clinically are we seeing? What kind of clinical indications? What kind of diagnoses does this patient have to give us that rationale that you should perform this test? We ask you to submit the history and physical information, which helps us to justify and support the need for the service as well. Also, a medication list and any prior vitamin D results, if you have them. And finally, a copy of an advanced beneficiary notice of non-coverage if one was given. So we are looking specifically in Part A. So this may mean that you have to get documentation from the physician's office, from that office visit, to support the services. It's really important that the Part A office and the Part B office and the Part A facility work together to make for a successful review when it's necessary. So please note, if you are a physician's office that requests this test to be run at a facility, you may have to send more information than just a requisition and order with a diagnosis to the facility. If the facility is requested to submit documentation to support the service, it will be your responsibility as a Part A facility to get that information from the Part B provider's office. And it's your responsibility as the Part A provider's office to give them that information so they can support the medical necessity of the service and get their reimbursement for the documentation and the claim. So let's kind of talk about how the review happens, the review itself. Everything that we've discussed so far is everything that's going to be looked at upon medical review. That starts with the covered indications that are listed in the LCD. We reviewed these earlier in the presentation, but upon medical review, that's the first thing that we look for, is what's the covered indication to support the medical necessity of the test. Also, what other indications are listed to also support medical necessity and frequency requirements. So we're going to look for physician's order for the test, and then any documentation by the physician to support the reason that that test was performed on that day for that beneficiary. Why is it necessary for Fred today? Medications that the patient is on can play into the need for the frequency and even the treatment of certain conditions that may help warrant the need for the test. So this is more of an ancillary type item, but it really helps with supporting the medical necessity of the services you're providing. Finally, if there's any prior lab results, you want to send those lab results upon medical review as well. We use these to verify frequency and also support medical necessity if it's outside those frequency requirements. And that helps us to understand, you know, if the test is routine or prophylactic in nature. So is it just a screening or is it actually diagnostic? So those are some of the things that we look for. So as we go to do medical review, we utilize again that local coverage determination and walk through all these things. What's our covered indication? Do we have additional information to support medical necessity? Is it ordered by a physician or non-physician practitioner if allowable in their state? Are there medications that play into the medical necessity of this? Do we have prior results? We look at all of that. And actually, we look at any documentation that you provide. So along with, you know, your physician orders, we're going to look at physician progress notes, et cetera, all those things that we had listed back here in the documentation to really help support this information. As we move on, let's talk about some common review findings that we see when we're reviewing these claims. Upon medical review of this laboratory test, we are seeing some repetitive findings that really I'm gonna take some time and discuss, and we'll break these down further in the next several slides. So the basic findings or the most common findings include missing clinical rationale, exceeding frequency limitations, and testing that's considered routine in nature. So let's look at missing clinical rationale first. That's our first documentation and our highest documentation error that our nurses are seeing. So they're missing the clinical rationale for the ordering and performing the vitamin D assay test. This error goes back to our slide that really reviews the documentation elements that you need to include for a successful review. We're looking to see that the test is medically necessary, so again, for Fred today. And the documentation supports that's the case. So we're going to be reviewing for documentation that the beneficiary has one of the listed clinical indications included in their diagnosis, that there's a presence of relevant medical history. So that, you know, could include a history and physical that was, you know, that you completed that. Finally, any prior relevant diagnostic tests or other procedures that were done that they do, and why those interventions related to ordering of the vitamin D testing. So as a provider, it's really very important for your documentation to paint a clear picture to support the clinical indications and that the services should be covered. As reviewers, we can only go off of what is in the documentation. So please keep that in mind. If it's not documented, it's not done. If it's not contained in the documentation or submitted with your documentation for review, we can't consider it done. All right, so as we move on, and we talked about some of these frequency testing, but it continues to be an error. So exceeding frequency limitations as they're listed in the LCD. And I'm not gonna go over these again because we pointed them out in the LCD and they're on the slide deck as well. Those frequency parameters, follow those when we're looking through your documentation and looking at information on any prior tests and results that you submit to us upon review. We still are seeing providers submitting claims for tests that are done at higher frequency than what's listed here and what's listed in the LCD. Remember, if the vitamin D test comes back within normal limits, typically, it would not be something we would expect providers to continue to test unless there is some sort of clinical indication to retest for the beneficiary whose results, you know, came back within normal limits. If that's the case, the progress notes from the physician should provide very clear rationale, but that provider's reasoning and information to support their clinical decision should be very evident to us of why you may be outside these review parameters. And one thing to keep in mind is, did we have a vitamin D and then somewhere in the course of the year, the person goes on a medication that could affect their vitamin D levels? At that point, after the person's been on the medication for some time, is there a reason outside of these frequency limitations to look at that vitamin D level again, even though prior to taking this medication, it was fine and within normal limits? If that's the case, we would want to see that listed in the physician's progress note. And then finally, our final common documentation error is testing for routine purposes. So, testing for routine purposes really is a no-go. We just don't cover that. We do see this more often than you'd think in the claims that are submitted during our TPE review. So this is not a standard test that Medicare will reimburse for routine purposes. The coverage criteria, including indication, clinical indications, rationale, et cetera, frequency parameters, that all must be documented and met in order for WPS and CMS to consider coverage for that service. So again, if there are indications, clinical indications and rationale, they need to be contained within the documentation that you submit to us for review. So at this time, I am going to actually show some live documentation that we've had submitted in the past for review. And we're just gonna kind of talk about some of the things that we see in documentation that we receive, just because I think it helps to drive things home from the provider perspective. I'm going to ask Jennifer, are you seeing this slide or this PDF file labeled provider order?
Yes, I am.
Perfect. All right. I'm not going to show you the entire chart. And so, you know, there will be information that we've talked about today that's not on here. And there may be information that we would expect to be contained within the order or the requisition that isn't here. But that doesn't mean it can't be contained somewhere else in the documentation. I'm just not going to show all of that because, you know, this is possibly 50 pages of information and we don't have time to go through 50 pages of information. So some of the things that we're going to talk about on this physician order, and this is just one example of what we have. So we have a physician name. We have the test to be performed. We have a diagnosis of vitamin D deficiency unspecified. So we know what test, what physician, and what the rationale is for. So this is one piece of the picture. So one thing I want to know. See down here, we have an E55.9 vitamin D deficiency unspecified. If during the course of treatment of your patient, you obtain a more specific diagnosis, we would expect that later in your testing, you would report it that way. I'm not saying that this is wrong by any means. I just want to send out a reminder that you should always code to the highest specificity possible, whether that's your diagnosis code, whether that's procedure codes, HCPCS codes, et cetera. Again, this was sent as a verbal order, so we would expect somewhere that you follow the guidelines for obtaining a verbal order, and if a physician signature is needed, that, you know, that is done as well. So that's just one example. So this is a fine example of how we may receive an order. This next one is some results history. So results of past vitamin D testing. So this tells us that this beneficiary received vitamin D assay testing on 4/13/23. And they had low results, 19.2, so just slightly below the cutoff level. The range listed here hits just below 20. So it would be considered deficient, vitamin D deficient. So prior to that, they received some testing a little over a year before that, and that was in normal range or at a sufficient level. And then in the year before that, they also were within the normal level. So we have within, within, and then we test again a year after the last and find out it's deficient. So one thing we are going to look for in your documentation is what is the indication going forward that we needed to look at the vitamin D again? What are the clinical indications? Is there signs and symptoms of vitamin D deficiency? Did the patient have a broken bone? Did they start on a medication that could potentially affect the vitamin D, et cetera? So these are things that we would expect to see, you know, in the supporting documentation as well. All right. So the next one is a physician progress note. And I'm going to kind of read through this. So this provider states up here at the beginning of their progress note, and I just have a little snippet of it. And they're really going over the results related to a prior sleep study, and that the patient's having symptoms like fatigue and weight gain, hypertension, forgetfulness, which could possibly be due to their poor sleep. The provider next discusses a possible diagnosis of Cushing's. However, this isn't confirmed, and there's no mention of any follow-up testing to look for or rule out thyroid disease, you know, that are ordered. They talk about antibiotic regime for strep throat and some concern related to the high blood pressure during the visit. So there's nothing in this progress note that was provided that gives us any clinical indication for this provider to have ordered the vitamin D assay testing, especially considering the results of the most recent test. And we have this, and I don't have this up for you, done in January of the same year, actually came back within normal limits. So we're missing the why or the clinical rationale to support the test performed. Again, we're gonna look throughout all the documentation that you submitted. So this is just one piece of the puzzle, but we turn here to see first, how did the physician support the need for the service? What is the physician seeing, hearing, smelling, et cetera? What drives them to believe there's a possibility of high or low vitamin D that would warrant testing at this time? From this progress note, we don't have that information. The progress note went on to give the orders and give the lab orders that they were making, but again, nothing further in there to support the reasoning for the surveys, for the service. So those are just some examples of documentation that we receive upon medical review and how we look at some of that documentation. So the next couple slides, these are just resources for you. Again, these are links. I'm gonna, you know, I take you out to the LCD, I take you out to that targeted probe and educate review process, the information on that. I've taken you out to that vitamin D resource that we have on our webpage. And if you need information about the ABN form and instructions, I've provided a link on here as well for you. So I'm going to quick recap so we have time for some questions. By participating today, you've now gained some of the knowledge that's necessary to make sure you help ensure compliance and successfully pass a Medicare audit of this service. So, and we accomplished that today by going over that coverage criteria and really driving what you have to have and what we look at within that coverage criteria. We went over those documentation requirements and why those specific components are important to make sure you submit them. And we also reviewed some recent medical review findings. And I really can't stress enough, if you are a Part B provider or a Part A facility, whichever, you know, happens to be reviewed, if you need information from that other entity, please make sure you are playing nice. And that you are providing that information to that other entity. By signing up to be a Medicare provider, you have also agreed to submit documentation to Medicare if we ask for it upon review. So it's really important that, you know, you help each other, make sure you pass and have successful reviews. So, Jennifer, I know a few questions have come in the chat. Are there any that you have not answered and I can cover?
Yes, there's two that we didn't get answered. I haven't gotten answered yet. So the first one asked, does WPS have billing edits in place to ensure payment is not made when the frequency limit have been exceeded? And if not, why not?
I don't know on this specific service if there's any billing edits in place. That's a great question. I will have to go back and see. A lot of times we can't put things in place like this because there are rules and there are exceptions to the rules. And this is one of those lab services that there may be an exception to the rule and it may be okay to have frequency limitations that are exceeded that, remember, diagnosis alone doesn't make it okay. Diagnosis is one component of it, but it's not the leading component. So sometimes we really need to look at that documentation to ensure. But I will double check and I'll let everyone know if there are any other frequency limitation edits in place for this type of service. All right, Jennifer, next question.
Let's see. So if the patient has osteoporosis and is on a medication like Prolia or Evenity, and they must adequately supplement with calcium and vitamin D, would testing once a year to make sure their levels are okay and don't require additional vitamin supplements be okay?
Yeah, generally, if the patient is on a medication regime, especially if it's a new medication regime, and you have documentation and reason to support why that service may be required more than once that year, generally that is okay to perform. Now, in the event that you have a feeling that Medicare may not cover for whatever reason, let's say they've been on their medication for quite a while and they are at, you know, a point where just testing once a year to ensure, you know, adequate levels is sufficient, but you feel the need to test perhaps outside the frequency limitations. If you have reason to believe they won't cover, I do say that that would be a good time to issue an ABN, explain to the patient that it may not be recovered at that time, and place the appropriate modifier on the claim.
Okay, we did get a question about resources for provider education, fraud and waste, abuse, and I'm going to put the training center website into the chat so that you can have that. We do have a lot of information on that. I don't know if, Mary Sue, you want to touch upon any more on that or just refer to the training center?
You know, that's a good time to bring up. There is, Ashley, a webinar that will be coming up soon on fraud, waste, and abuse. I know Tom Ryan, one of our coworkers, is hosting that. Not sure the exact date of that, but yeah, do go to our training center page and just do a general search on fraud, waste, and abuse, and you may be able to find some additional resources on our webpage as well. But I know there is a specific training coming up just on that.
And we do have one last question. What about providers that order the test but do not participate in Medicare? What is their obligation to provide the hospital with the requested records?
Well, that's something you'll have to work out with that provider, because if your physician is not a Medicare physician, but their information is pertinent for the hospital to get their claim paid, you will probably need to work out some sort of participation agreement with those providers that, in the event you happen to be reviewed for a laboratory test that they are requesting, that they will provide you those medical records. So that would be something that you would need to work out with them, or else they would have to know that perhaps your facility will make the decision not to run lab tests for them, because if they're not going to give you the information necessary, then they can seek out their laboratory services elsewhere. You know, I mean, that just may be a decision your CEOs, CFOs need to make regarding that. And then I think that kind of takes us to the end of our questions. Please note that, you know, I said right now reviews are going on in J8A, but that could be expanded to other jurisdictions. That won't be expanded before the end of this year, but going into the next year, we could expand those as well. So on behalf of myself and Jennifer and all of Medical Review, we want to thank you for your participation in today's event. This concludes our webinar, and you may now disconnect.